Anyway, Jai Hind, everyone. Good evening. It's a pleasure and an honor for me to be here and to be invited and speak on my experience and on some moral lessons from the battlefield. I'm proud to be a soldier. I've been in the army for 29 years. I retired last year. My father was in the army. My grandfather was in the army. Like many of us, the ones that I joined the army with, the army that my forefathers served, and the ones that we have today, we are all proud of the fact that we've always responded to the needs of our country, always, every time. We've always, whether it's a riot, or it's an insurgency situation, or it's a full-fledged war, or it's just an aid to civil authority, the armed forces have always responded. And there's something that differentiates us from the rest of them, in the sense that there is something that actually inspires us. Right here in IMA, you have the Indian Military Academy, you know, which trains young men into officers to lead men in missions that our country demands of them, to kill and be killed, to defend what is valuable in our country. You know, people are picked up. The motto of our academy is the safety, honor, welfare of your country and countrymen come first, always and every time. Of the men you command comes next and your own comes last. And that is something that is instilled in all of us, majority of us. There are exceptions, but the majority of us are instilled with those values that inspires us to take up weapons on behalf of people and defend those values that that our country stands for. And what are these values? That is this democratic country that we have, an ancient culture, secular country. We are trained. And what we are different from the rest of the other professions, are different is that we deal with violence in a large scale. We are young boys and men, girls and boys are picked up and trained in the art of war. We learn how to handle weapons, and we also have a trade-off in the sense not only can we kill, but we can also be killed in defending what is valuable to our country. And now this violence is something that we all learn to deal with. And how do you moderate that violence? We all brought up with that value that violence is evil intrinsically. Anyone who's violent is a bad man. He's mentally off his rockers. He's psychologically imbalanced. Now, how do you handle that kind of violence and death and destruction for a cause while retaining sanity? Now, this is something that has baffled people since ancient times. In our own scriptures, the use of violence has been validated by Krishna when he advises Arjun that for the end that you have in mind, the means of war is necessary, where you have to bear arms, you have to kill not only your relatives, your ones you respect, for defending what is valuable for you, for attaining that end. And it's something you had the Americans justify the use of nuclear bomb, atom bomb in Japan, when they dropped it and they said for the larger good it was important to kill a few lakhs. And they justified that, you know, it's like a doctor suggesting that you need to cut your arms off to save your body from amputation. So that's the justification that we have for use of violence for the larger good. So, but it's a primordial struggle. It's between your own life and the other. You have to kill or be killed. That a thin line divides that humanity which defines your own survival and your own extinction. So that brings me, every soldier has a personal experience. I have my own, where I had those choices to be made in those moments in the battlefield where I bore arms to go, and we were, in a sense, I knew that there was a liability of death on me, and we were proud to serve in the army. I joined the regiment, the Brigade of the Guards, an elite regiment, and my father served in that regiment too. And in 1994, I was posted to Manipur. In those days, the army was pulled out because of the problems that we had in Kashmir, which had this thing. And the entire army was out, and the whole area was actually turned into a booby trap minefield where there was death lurking at every corner. There were ambushes that taking place. Insurgents had taken over large tracts of those territories. Bridges were being blown off and ambushes were being conducted because it's a treacherous terrain. Hilly and carnivorous bees, pythons, leeches, everything are infested there, and we don't have the connection that we're there. And insurgents were there who actually turned those hideouts into strongholds, and the army had to again regain control on those areas. And I went into an encounter in Manipur in Longdeepabram, in a village where the previous one was. There, I was shot, I had 4 bullets in my chest. I'd entered the room without knocking. Those guys got angry and they fired at me. I had a grenade on my leg, which blew off a portion of my leg.
And I was losing life, so I decided to use a rocket launcher, and I told them that I'm going to blow up your house. Before I wanted to report back to my commanding officer that I've accomplished my mission. So that's the time two young children came out. You know, this boy on the right, he was hardly 6 years old, and there was another girl who was about 10. And in those moments, there was a helicopter hovering over us. I had to decide, you know, I was there as a soldier. I was there to protect those people. There was no way, there was a battle between me and the insurgents. We represented the Constitution of India, which said that everyone is equal, it's a secular country, and they were fighting for a cause which they believed was dear to them. They said Nagaland for Christ, Nagaland and other things. There was a competition between us and them. The fight was between me and the insurgents. The fight was nowhere with this young child. The child who was there, who was gasping, he wouldn't have survived. So in those few moments, I decided that if anyone had a right to live in those moments, it was this child. He never knew which tribe he belonged to, which region, which religion, what the fight was about. And so I requested the pilot, who happened to be my course mate, to evacuate them. And he said, what do I tell your parents? I said, say we saved this young child. So that's it. Whatever it is, a long story short, the villagers probably prayed for me. I survived. I went to the best hospital. I had a good time. I got posted to good places. After that, the army gave me an award. And my commanding officer recommended me for Ashok Chakra. And I went on. I never expected to go back to that village. I was in Bangalore Military School. I was a vice principal. Then I went on to army headquarters. And finally, I got selected in the Ministry of Defense, and then moved on to National Security Council with the Prime Minister's office. So it was a big, big leap for me in the sense, personally, I've had. I suddenly got a call in 2010 from the village. A patrol had gone there and found a small little memorial made in my name, saying Captain Pillay, you know, died here to save two children of ours. So I got a call from there, and my commander and a friend of mine said, why don't you come and visit your own grave? That'd be interesting. So I said, I must fly down. So within a day, I was there. And I went there, and they gave me a rousing reception. That's the boy who turned, he turned into a strapping young boy. And that's the other girl. So we went back there, met all of them. It was going back. And I also met the guy who shot me, this guy. He actually shot me. When he came to check, he said, I'm a very good marksman. I want to check, where did I hit you? So anyway, then I moved on to the kind of love and affection, that small humane act, that moral choice that I made of seeing the equivalence of all human life as one, you know, to defend what is valuable, I think made a lot of difference. So he wasn't my enemy. I had no grouse against this man. He'd never stolen my girlfriend. So there was nothing. So the combat was over. It was a well-fought Red Blues the winner. He surrendered, and we treated him humanely as per the conventions, as per the law of our land. I told him never to take a weapon again, and he never did take a weapon. After he spent his time in jail, he came back home, became a farmer, and he was the one who received me, actually. I was a bit surprised when he told me I was the one who shot him. So anyway, it's a good story. So then, have the next one. I went back, because by then I was working in the Prime Minister's office, I could use a lot of influence and good grace. You know, they say when you have a good deed in mind, the world conspires with you. So I had a lot of help. I got a truck gifted by the Home Secretary, Mr. GK Pillay. We got a lot of orange orchards done, the next one. Then we had water supply schemes done there. I got a road made. We had sewing machines there. We cut a road. General Huda was the army commander, subsequently was the GOC. They never had a road even after those 16 years. So he immediately sent a bulldozer. And in 26 days, we cut out a 24-kilometer road for them. We made them. And the road was not good enough because in bad weather, it became slushy. Next one. So we had a bamboo mission trained because they are very good at bamboo making and maths and everything. So we trained them in vocation. The boy who got shot has become, he's now working for ICICI Bank. In fact, his nephew is here in Dehradun. He was supposed to come, but he's not turned up. He's enrolled in that called university here. So we did a lot of projects, and next, water supply and other things that, like I told you, there's an orange, the oranges are very tasty there, and there's this church there which prays for me every Saturday from morning till evening, and so there's so much of power in that prayer. So I, whenever they ask me anything, I said okay, let me give it a shot, and it happens. Next one. So there was this road, this is the prayer ministry. These women chant from morning dawn to dusk on Saturdays, and they pray that, you know, so that peace may prevail. So they asked me for this road. I got Mr. Pallam Raju, who was the defense minister then, minister of state then, later HRD minister. He sanctioned the road, but it got caught in a lot of red tape, and the previous government couldn't give the sanctions. So it was stuck in, this road was sanctioned by GK Pillay, the Home Secretary and others, but got stuck in red tape. So I just took a shot, I went to Gadkari. I asked for an appointment, they are so busy, they don't, but I got an appointment, I don't know how. So I went and told him that I need to make a loan, and he made a national highway in that, he sanctioned a national highway by turning, he asked the secretary, how do you make a road there in the state? He said, we can't make state roads. So he says, then why don't we make a national highway? So he's saying, how do you make it? He says, connected to whichever the state next to it. So 10 kilometers into the next state, and it's a national highway, work has been completed, and the project has been completed. Now the construction will start. It's going to be a two-lane highway. It's going to be connected. And in the sense, I was, like I told you, it's a conspiracy. The President of India on my retirement, when I retired, called me. It's a big honor for me. Normally, generals get those appointments. So I was invited, and he gave me a farewell on my retirement. He's the Commander-in-Chief, the Supreme Commander. So getting a call on of the Supreme Commander is a big honor. This is a rare honor for a colonel. So I went there, in the sense. So what I'm trying to say is that our ancient philosophers and our ancient religions, everyone said any war, anything, any negotiation between two people on unjust terms is not going to make you happy. When you treat people equally, when you see the value in every human life, you know, when you see those dilemmas that are there, you weigh against your own moral conscience. You see the equivalence of all human beings. Can you just skip it, run it through? You know, where you are able to measure your military necessity and this thing. So when Truman ordered the atom bomb, he probably measured necessity, and later on he justified that killing a few lakhs was necessary to save the millions who may have died. But it was a traumatic incident nonetheless. But the fact is that you weigh your balance, your military necessity between humanity and others. And you always deal with the other person in moral values, your own moral compass. It's the same in every single thing. Play the next one. So finally, I want to just, the military service is a big honor. It's an honor to speak to young children. We never know what idea we may have planted, how the seed germinates in your head. You never know what you turn this into. It's good to always understand that always the flourishing of our civilization, and always our own Indian civilization has flourished all these years, is not because we've been rigid, we've been compromising, we've understood the other person. We've grown with each invasion. It's not like we were one composite, we have grown stronger and stronger. This country is a unique country. Go back, look at a map, which is 5,000 years old, you find India there, Indians there. You look at map today, and you look at the map 100 years hence, you'll still find Indians around. The strength of ours is the fact that we've been able to adjust, to compromise, to understand the other person's viewpoint, and to adopt. You know, the harshest of invaders have come in, and they've understood and adopted an Indian way of life, you know, where you compromise, you've coexisted. So that's so important for us. So in the end, I'll just say, there's a small little clip that I have. When I retired, I went back to the village, and the villagers gave me 100 acres of land. So I just... This is India Today report, which is carried.
A very brave counter-terror operation where he was grievously injured, but he chose to save the lives of two children, two little children who were caught in the crossfire. It was either their lives or his. He chose theirs. God saved him. That village in Manipur has now adopted him. Take a look at his story. We'll also be speaking to him. Shaurya Chakra awardee Colonel DPK Pillay, this moment is the soldier's real medal, winning the hearts and minds of his countrymen and women, citizens who he is meant to serve and protect. Pillay Pamai, or little brother Pillay from Kerala, is called for people of Longdeepabram, a small village in Manipur. These tears flow as the brave soldier and the entire village remember the night of January 25th, 1994, when he lay bleeding. He'd been shot in the chest, arms, abdomen and feet. 23 years, that one moment when this soldier stared fearlessly at death, yet saved the lives of two young children injured in the crossfire. Both are now grown up. While waiting for a helicopter to rescue him, the brave young officer spotted two children who'd been shot at and injured and decided to put their safety first.
He is the one who replaced our traditional warriors. I want to give him the title Malant, which means the person who safeguard, the person who defend, the person who promote the village.
Then a young platoon commander of the 8th Battalion of the Guards Regiment, Pillay, suffered grievous injuries during a three-hour-long gun battle with the NSC and IM insurgents. The 26-year-old took bullets in the chest and arms, suffered a fracture in the spine, and a grenade exploded right over his foot before he fell unconscious. The hero has touched hundreds of lives, not just these two children. He even moved the NSC and IM insurgents to lay down their arms. The Braveheart is now a solar soldier, carrying solar lights for every home of the village. 100 of those sponsored by the Assam Rifles. A grateful village has now adopted their savior, offering him 100 acres of land, which he turned down. This soldier says he needs no land, only some place in their hearts. Bureau Report, India Today.
That's had a very good retirement. Thank you very much.